Sheikh Yasser, thank you very much for agreeing to do this interview today.
Thank you for having me.
Welcome to London. I want to ask you, obviously, about the issue of the burning issue of sectarianism that we're experiencing these days. Now, I'm going to get straight into it, ask you a very direct question. I've listened to YouTube interviews that you've given in the past. You've been very critical of Shias. You've used very harsh language against Shias. Do you regret that now?
What I said about Shias probably around 17, 18 years ago was in fact quite inflammatory and stereotyping an entire segment of people. And yes, I do regret the language that I used. I do regret what I said. And I do believe that I have moved on from that, and I have given enough lectures and videos publicly and, you know, interviews which demonstrate that I am now a different person. We all go through phases in our lives. And at a younger age, I kind of took what was taught to me from a certain, you know, methodological background and accepted it without verification. And I also was also a bit more of a fiery person in my early 20s. And I think, you know, age and wisdom and experience, really, and interacting with people tempers one down. And yes, I believe I have, you know, moved on from that type of rhetoric and broad-reaching language.
Why have you changed your position?
Well, as I said, I think there's many reasons. First and foremost, just age, experience, just being with the people. Secondly, realizing that, you know, what I was taught really was a bit of a cut-and-paste job. So, you know, they'll find one book that has a phrase and they say, oh, all Shiites believe, you know, what is in this book. And it doesn't work that way. You know, when Islamophobes quote even the Quran and they say, oh, the Quran says slay them wherever you find them, for example. You know, we Muslims get offended. And we should get offended. We say, hold on a sec. There's a context. There's a way to understand it. You don't just take three phrases and then, you know, smear an entire religion. Frankly, Sunnis and Shiites, we do the same to each other. And we just take a phrase found in any book, not even the Quran. It's like a book written by a human being. You know, the Quran is from Allah, but we'll take a book written by a human being and then just assume the entire population out of context believes in those three, four, you know, phrases.
But I just want to clarify, are you saying that in your early 20s you got it wrong theologically, or are you just saying that, all right, I'm a bit older now, we should all live together, I haven't changed my theological position, but we should just try and get along?
No, it's a little bit of both, in that there were certain things that I said that, yes, they were wrong theologically, yes. And there are other things that I said that, you know, it lacked wisdom. Like, it doesn't need to be said in the manner that I said it. So it's a little bit of both, that we need to understand that, and I've said this very publicly at one of the largest conferences in America, that clerics, imams, theologians, Sunni imams obviously, and Shiite, you know, clerics and theologians, we need to understand that even if we don't specifically incite our followers to kill each other, if we use violent rhetoric and if we for years systematically stigmatize the other, then even if we don't pull the trigger, if one of our followers is being fed hatred of the other and being fed this imagery that is simply not valid, when that follower pulls the trigger, then frankly, the cleric or the rhetoric that they've heard in the mosques and whatnot, it does take a healthy share of the blame.
You have said before, maybe it was 20 years ago, I'm not sure, but you have said that basically Sunnis shouldn't have kind of any contact with Shias. Again, you're attracting that now? You think that there should be dialogue, there should be interaction?
So this is a very difficult question to answer because it's multifaceted. On the one level, historically speaking, historically being totally neutral here, Twelver Shiism and mainstream Sunnism has basically always been slightly separate, in that their mosques, their institutions of clergy, their textbooks, basically there's just been a mutually acceptable you know, method to disagree, like let the other keep on doing what they're doing, and there's not been a type of melding of ways. I don't see a problem in continuing down that tradition, because, and here's the point here, and I'm being very frank here, there are theological issues from each side that are very difficult for them to swallow about the other, right? It's a very sensitive topic. And I'm a pragmatist. I'm not some, you know, utopic idealist. I believe in being pragmatically realistic. And the fact of the matter is that, you know, as a Sunni, certain elements of Shiite theology are difficult for Sunnis to swallow. And I understand, even though I don't agree, I understand that it's a two-way street, that there are certain elements in Sunnism that are very difficult for mainstream Shiism to simply ignore. You know, it's as if, you know, for us, for example, this is the common issue is the status of the Sahaba and the mothers of the believers. It's a very sensitive issue. And when we hear inflammatory language against those whom we love the most after the Prophet ﷺ, honestly, for those who love these people, you cannot reconcile fully with somebody who's insulting, you know, our mothers, if you like, for example, right? At the same time, and so I'm being pragmatic here, at the same time, what needs to be done is to temper down on both sides, the rhetoric and the anger, the inflammatory language. It is a two-way street. You know, I'm not saying, you know, Sunnis are guilty or Shias are guilty. No, there are guilty parties on both sides. And there's inflammatory language on both sides. Clerics from within each tradition need to temper down their own constituents.
When I've spoken to Shia scholars about this, they've acknowledged that there are extremists on both sides. But what they say is, you know, comparing anti-Sunni rhetoric coming from Shias to anti-Shia rhetoric coming from Sunnis is a bit like comparing anti-black racism with anti-white racism. They're just not on the same level at all.
I don't feel qualified to comment on that. Just because Shiites are statistically a minority, I don't know if it's fair to portray them as being the underdog all the time. I mean, the type of inflammatory language that I have heard myself, you know, online from certain clerics. And here's the problem. The average Sunni will not differentiate between an extremist Shiite cleric and a moderate Shiite cleric, right? That's the problem I need to educate. But there are extremist Shiite clerics online and here in London and others. Their rhetoric is simply vulgar. It's beyond what is even decent and normal, right?
People like Yasser Habib.
I didn't want to mention his name, but if you mention his name, that's definitely the number one example that comes to my mind. Sadly, he shares the same name as me, but he shares nothing else other than that first name. And so when you have somebody like this individual, and a Sunni listens to this, and he's dressed in the Shiite garb, and he appears to be coming from, you know, the proper seminaries and whatnot, I'm not saying this is right, but it's understandable that he falls into the error of assuming all Shiites are like this. And it is incomprehensible for such a person to understand how anybody could hate a wife of the Prophet so much as to accuse her of murdering the Prophet himself, for example, amongst other of his claims, right? And this Sunni wonders, where are the other Shiites tempering this man down?
But when a grand Ayatollah like Sistani or Khamenei issues a fatwa explicitly
I have read this, yes.
forbidding
yes.
Shias mm-hmm. to curse the Sahaba or the mother of the believers.
And that's a great
fatwa. That seems to be ignored, isn't it?
Yeah, well, maybe it's not publicized as much as it should. I might agree with you there. And that is great to hear that type of rhetoric. That I wish that were more common, and I wish that elements of Shiism would you know, follow that. But as I'm saying, so here we have this difficult issue of you're concentrating on the grievances of one group. There are grievances on the other side as well. Right, it's not a simplistic issue of, you know, black America versus white America, where clearly the grievances were overwhelmingly on the one side. I do think it's fair to say that in some situations, in some political conflicts, you know, it's quite clear that the violence or the rhetoric is more on one side than the other. Maybe sometimes Sunnism, maybe sometimes Shiism. That's
really?
My point here.
Can I press you on that? Is that really true? I mean, are Sunnis being killed because they're Sunnis? Whereas Shias are being killed because they're
Shia. We're diverging into the political scene, and I'm a bit hesitant to do that, but I think Syria is an example that needs to be said. That yes, people are being killed merely for being Sunni.
Not for political reasons? Because they're Sunnis?
Well, obviously, here's the issue. In Islam, politics and theology are intertwined, right? So you cannot just differentiate here for the sectarian violence in Iraq, for the sectarian violence in Syria. The two, you know, these communities, Shias and Sunnis, it's not just theology for them. They have, you know, ages-old history of conflict, right? Which is specific to their region. As a theologian, I can speak independently of the conflicts in Syria and in Iraq and others and say, well, these are the disagreements, these are what we can agree to cooperate. But I cannot speak to somebody in Iraq, for example, right, who has lost a son or a daughter to this type of sectarian violence, who has a history going back 50, 100 years. My rhetoric is not going to be acceptable to him because that person has a specific history that is beyond just mere theology.
Can I ask you a very direct question? Theologically, do you consider Shias to be Muslim?
Anybody who says La ilaha illallah Muhammad Rasulullah and prays and has a religiosity to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the love of the Messenger, I consider him to be a Muslim unless and until something comes from this person that clearly negates a very basic understanding of Islam. So generally speaking, any group, Sunni or Shia, who says La ilaha illallah, Muhammadur Rasulullah, and has worship basically of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and an acceptance of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam as the messenger, this person is a Muslim unless and until something comes that negates that Islam. And therefore, in my estimation, and I've said this many times, we accept all people who say the kalima and show signs of religiosity, unless and until something comes that negates that. So if we come across a Shia and we find him praying and having, you know, respect for the signs of Islam, we will assume this person to be a Muslim. But there are certain elements that if we find in anybody, let me give you an example that is neither Sunni or Shia. If we come across somebody who says the kalima, but then he believes in a man being a prophet, or even worse, a man being God himself, it doesn't matter, his kalima will be negated, correct? So there are certain extremist Shiite tendencies. They are not mainstream. Sunnis sometimes make them mainstream in Shiism. They're not. For example, the claim that the Quran has been corrupted. I'll be very frank here, as a theologian, anybody who says, I don't care if he's a Sunni or he's a progressive, because there are progressives that say the same thing. You know, liberals or Muslims, whatever the term you use, if you believe the Book of Allah has not been preserved, it doesn't matter, your kalima has been negated, right? So these are the points here, is that generically, the Sunnis and Shiites are Muslim, yes. But when you come to a specific individual and you find an ideology or a theology that negates the kalima, then no, I would not consider this to be Islam.
I'm glad that we talked about the anti-Sunni rhetoric by certain Shias like Yasser Habib. I'm glad you made that point. I think it's very important. What about the anti-Shia rhetoric by Sunnis? What I found in my research is that it's becoming quite mainstream. It's always been on the fringes in the past, generally, but because of political events recently, it's becoming quite mainstream. And mainstream Sunni scholars who are respected and have massive followings all over the world use, you know, derogatory terms like Rafida, like, you know, every 2 seconds, and they repeat these stereotypes about Shias, which you've just dismissed yourself. What do you think about, I mean, these people are people that you associate with as well, maybe that you work with. What is your advice to them?
So I think you mentioned a very important point, and that is due to recent political occurrences, due to recent political factors. As I said, it is impossible to dissociate pure theology from the historical context of an individual Muslim living in a Sunni and Shiite sectarian violence. So what's happened in Iraq? I mean, each side has heard horror stories about the other that are true. I have no doubt that at some level in some places, Sunnis have brutally massacred Shiites. I have no doubt that's true. But the stories that I've heard, because I am a Sunni, generally involve Shiites massacring Sunnis. Right? And I have no doubt that the Shiites hear the exact opposite more, and there's an element of truth on both sides. So in this, now, which one of the two is more? Obviously, each one will say the other is more, right? And I am not an analyst to verify 100%. Nonetheless, you know, I have to say, the fact that the Shiites are currently in political power, they're getting vengeance for what previously 30 years has happened. And I have no qualm saying, you know, Saddam's reign was a reign of terror, and, you know, he especially was harsh on the Shiites. There's no question he was, right? I'm not defending Saddam and what he did. But now the flip side of the coin, when the power is now in the other camp, I think it's pretty true to say that they will take advantage of that and get rid of some of those grievances in a manner that will cause even more grievances. So in this type of violence, I'm not justifying, but I'm saying put yourself in their shoes as well. They will find comfort in stereotyping the other. They will find, well, of course they're going to do this to us because they're this and they're that and they're this and they're that. And that type of anger, I'm not saying it's justified. I'm saying, what else do you expect when your mother has been this and your sister that and your daughter that?
But from a scholar, I mean, from an ordinary person who's emotionally involved, you can expect that. But from a scholar, shouldn't they have more wisdom and responsibility?
But there is actual sectarian warfare going on. Somebody's attacking your house. You cannot speak the rhetoric of Gandhi. You have to defend your family. You have to defend your wife and children, right? This is a real situation. I'm speaking from the comfort of London right now. I'm speaking from the comfort of America. And I'm telling Muslims in America and England, let's not bring violence into our lands, right? Let's not bring the Sunni Shia sectarian divide to spill blood within us here. But I cannot and I never will pretend to be a Syrian scholar speaking to the Syrian people, an Iraqi scholar speaking to the Iraqi people. That's not my job.
But because to the Muslims of the West, who you do have an
influence over? Definitely, the Muslims. No, because that's not my job, because I'm not living that life. Again, put yourself in the shoes of the Iraqi people. There's actual bloodshed going on both ways. Put yourself in the shoes of the Syrians. There are militias, gangs on both sides. The rhetoric of Gandhi is out the window here. It's my son that's being attacked, right? So in that type of environment, it's not appropriate for me to comment, you know, on what they should or should not do. I am commenting on what I know best, and that's my people and the situation that we are in. And that is that there is no need for us, it is un-Islamic for us, to import that type of violence and that type of bloodshed, you know, amongst us over here.
How big an issue do you think this is? I mean, some people have told me that, you know, it's all exaggerated and it's not a, you know, the risk of bloodshed in the West, like it's happening in Syria and Iraq, isn't that great. Do you consider this a priority for the Ummah?
I don't think there's a big issue of actual bloodshed. There might be an instance or two every year, as you know. It's not something that we're very much battling with. What we are battling with is rising tensions and animosity. Now, that's dangerous because it could lead to something, but I don't think it'll lead to bloodshed. It is awkward, really. You know, I mean, there are large communities of Shiites in America, and because of what's happening in these regions, the tensions have simmered. You know, there were, for example, associations that would cooperate on joint projects for the Muslim community, and tensions have risen here. So, for example, battling Islamophobia. You know, for years, Sunnis and Shiites would join hands and battle Islamophobia. Well, what's happened is, because of these tensions, it's very difficult for Sunnis and Shiites to sit on the table without bringing in some of that rhetoric, without saying, oh, you guys did this and you guys did that. And what we've seen is some good projects that were meant to unify for the sake of the greater community are being hampered. And that's something that is perhaps more, you know, relevant to us here in the West.
I want to ask you about Saudi Arabia, because you were trained there, you did your theological training there. When I went on Hajj a few years ago, I went to the Maktaba, the bookshop opposite the Haram. I saw blatantly anti-Shia and anti-Sufi literature in English on sale, while millions of Hujjaj, who are Shia and Sufi, were doing Hajj. My research indicates that the vast majority of sectarianism promoted around the world is promoted by the Saudi authorities. Your comments on that?
I wouldn't feel qualified to comment on the second bit of the vast majority. I mean, that's something that I think requires a little bit more research. But no doubt, the theology that is taught in that region is inherently anti-everything. I mean, it's not just Shia or Sufi. You're probably not familiar with this, but even intra-Sunni disputes, right? In fact, Sufism is a strand of Sunni Islam. But there are other, you know, theologies within Sunnism that theology is very much opposed to. And I've written an article recently about this. It's entitled On Salafi Islam. And one of my criticisms really that I have of the movement as it exists today is its harsh attitude towards other Muslims. There's a time and a place, there's a rhetoric, there's a language, there's an audience that needs to be used when you talk about these sensitive topics. And I do not think it is healthy for the average Muslim who is struggling just to be a Muslim to be fed anti-Sufi, anti-Shi'i, anti-this rhetoric. You need to build this person's iman before you start destroying other people from his perspective.
In my conversations with other scholars, both Shia and Sunni, not all of them, but some of them, and I want to put this to you, they fear that Sunni Islam is becoming Wahhabized. And they consider this the greatest internal threat to Sunni Islam itself, perhaps in its history. And they liken it to the Khawarij, for example. And they say the answer to this is actually to take Sunni Islam back to its heart, which is in Al-Azhar, rather than in the deserts of Najd. Again, your comment on that, please.
Firstly, I think historically that is a little bit ridiculous, because the heart of Islam was Arabia, not Azhar. So I think it's a bit of a historical anomaly.
Yes, factually, to say that. But you understand the sentiment.
I know, I understand. But yeah, that's an interesting point there. This is a very complicated question. And I think what we see is that Wahhabism has become the bogeyman to blame all of the woes of current Islamdom on. And I think this simplistic issue of finding a scapegoat and blaming everything on it It's far more multifaceted than that, far more multifaceted. And one cannot, you know, begin to analyze in a 5-minute interview. The fact of the matter is that, yes, there are some problems that arise from Salafist ideology, but we have far greater problems in the Ummah. We have far bigger issues than merely those that arise from an understanding of Sunni Islam that historically goes back a long time. And that's really the point here. What is termed, quote-unquote, Wahhabism or Salafism, it has its roots going back, you know, over 1,200 years, a literal fierce defense of the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ. That movement has really been around for, you know, 12 centuries, 13 centuries. It's nothing new. It's manifested itself in different ways. And to call Salafism Kharijism, I think is theologically inaccurate. I speak as a theologian here. Yes. Kharijism, its very essence is to consider a Muslim who commits a sin to be a non-Muslim. If you lie, if you cheat, if you steal, you're a non-Muslim. And Salafism does not say that at all. In fact, you know, Salafism says only if you commit shirk are you not a Muslim. And that's standard Sunni practice. Now, so the harshness that Salafis exhibit is un-Islamic, but it's not Kharijite. And I think it's easy now. Here's the smearing we talked about.
And Salafis aren't just one-dimensional as well,
and
are they?
And Salafis are not just trends. One-dimensional. Yeah. Not all Salafis are harsh. Not all Salafis are this and that. So I think we talked about the smearing that Sunnis are doing to Shiites. Well, frankly, that's a lot of that's happening against Wahhabism and Salafism. And I say this as somebody who has kind of left, you know, organically, basically moved out of the movement, I say, you know. I used to be part of that movement. Now I consider myself, I've basically moved on from the movement. I'm not opposed to it. I'm still sympathetic to certain elements, but I'm no longer a card-carrying member. So I say this as somebody who's moved on, that one needs to be very frank. The type of smearing that takes place against Shiism, from your perspective, I think takes place perhaps even more so in some extent, you know, against what they now call Wahhabism. And I think one needs to be a little bit more accurate, a little bit more intellectual, a little bit more analytical, and analyze what exactly is it that people are disagreeing with. Is it the attitude? Is it the harshness? Or is it the actual theology, for example, of you know, not invoking the saints, for example, right? And this is really the crux of what Salafism is about, direct relationship between man and God, right?
I've only got one more question, and then I'll perhaps let you say something that perhaps I haven't asked you. I'll give you that opportunity. But yeah, I've asked you all the tough questions. I just wonder whether you feel that practically what can be done to bridge these gaps. I know there are certain unity conferences. Mm. They seem to be a bit of a waste of time to me. They often are organized by Shias, mm-hmm. And there are a few token cities that come along. Mm-hmm. It seems to me the Sunni community isn't really interested in the unity, whereas the Shia community is. Maybe because they're a minority, they feel under threat.
Exactly, yeah.
Practically, what can be done, do you think? At an elite level and a grassroots level to bridge these gaps?
Very good question. See, much can be done. And I think one of the most difficult issues really is the big elephants in the room, right? There are huge issues that these unity conferences, in my opinion, the reason why they're failures is because they ignore the elephants in the room. And you cannot have any type of dialogue between Sunnis and Shiites without acknowledging and then basically, you know, clarifying, you know, what are these big elephants that are causing such tension between the communities. Unless and until, and the point is, these unity conferences are naively utopic in that there's going to be this harmony and love between these two movements. That's never existed in, you know, the 12 centuries these two sects have been around. There's always been some tension. Sometimes it's worse, sometimes it's tolerated. But never in the history of Islam have 12 Shiites and mainstream Sunnis had the same mosque. Never have they had the same clergy. Never have they had the same, you know. And so to assume that's going to happen now really is just, it's just idealistic. It's not going to happen. And neither should it, because there are fundamental differences. So here's the point. Why do we need to talk about unity? Let's talk about toleration and let each group be what it is. Let's aim for a realistic goal. And I think if we aim for a realistic goal, perhaps something can be accomplished, right? As I said, there are some serious theological issues between the two movements. Let's acknowledge them. Let's not just hold hands and sing kumbaya. That's an American expression. I don't know if you know it or not. But let's not just hold hands and ignore all of these very tense issues. No, let's acknowledge, look, there are very fundamental differences between our two movements, right? What can be done to minimize bloodshed and violence? To minimize tension? Where can we cooperate? Certain councils in Europe want to ban the hijab. Certain countries want to do this. Sunnis and Shiites can and should come together and work together to battle Islamophobia, right? that's something, let's agree to cooperate on these types of areas. And let's agree to not cooperate on other areas. I mean, we're not going to hold joint Islamic events together, by and large.
Really? Is that not possible? Joint prayers, is that not possible?
It is possible amongst those segments of the community that do not really, are not passionate about theology. Yes, it is. And there are many such people. There are many
such
people.
And you're not against that?
I'm not against that, but I am a theologian.
So you wouldn't do it personally yourself?
No, I wouldn't. Frankly, I wouldn't. Because, as I said, these are very fundamental differences, right? So if somebody feels, you know, comfortable doing that, that's good for them, alhamdulillah. And I mean, I said this very publicly, and there's no issue here at all. Wallahi, it's a fact that my father came to America in 1963, right? He was one of the first Muslim immigrants to Houston, Texas. And in the 60s, people didn't have the luxury of being Sunni or Shia. There were so few Muslims, they had to work together. The first mosque was built by Sunnis and Shiites. Why? Because the greatest groups, the largest groups that came were from Pakistan and Iran at the time. Egypt was going to come later on, but Pakistanis and Iranis were the first groups of students that came to America. So my father tells me that back in the 60s and early 70s, the concept of Sunni Shia just did not exist. They all came together, they all financed the masjid, they all cooperated together, and Sunnis allowed the Shiites to do their 10th of Muharram thing, and Shiites didn't participate in when the Sunnis did their stuff, but they came together for Eid. Then what happened, as the money came, as the people came, as the communities grew, in the late 70s, people realized, you know what, this is causing some tension. So, you know, the two messages basically were separated and they agreed to disagree. Now, if I were in America in the 60s, should I be so naive and utopic to say, no, Sunnis and Shia should not pray? That's useless rhetoric. You have to do it. There's no alternative. But now that the two communities are financially independent, right? Frankly, there has not been much effort in my own community and in other communities to build one joint masjid. And I don't think there will be such an effort. If there is an effort, will I oppose it? No. But will I be spearheading it, campaigning for it? Also no, because I'm a pragmatist in the end of the day. I'm not aiming for ignoring these differences. I'm aiming for a civil society where we simply let them be and they can also let us be. Where we minimize the angry rhetoric and the gross stereotyping that occurs. Where if we find a Sunni who is inciting extra hatred and violence, we tone that down, and we ask the Shiites to do the same about cursing the Sahaba and slandering the mothers of the believers, that get rid of that type of rhetoric. Let us not hear that rhetoric. You have different practices. You believe in the Imams. You want to do the 10th of Muharram. Then I don't think any Sunni would be enraged by that. But when you curse the companions or you slander the mothers of the believers, I mean, an average Sunni really, it's, and understandably so, feels very moved by this. So both communities need to tone down. And if they do, I think it's very realistic to have a civil society. And also let there be dialogue. It's healthy. Let there be debates about the theologies for those who are interested. Have a room, hire it, whoever's interested come, right? This should not be spread to the mosques. This should not be spread to the Muslim who's barely a Muslim, who's struggling with Islam. Those who are advanced students of seminaries, right? Those who are interested in theological semantics and whatnot, these dialogues have a time and a place and have an outlet, because if you don't have that outlet, there will be the fiery rhetoric coming as well, right? So that's my practical solution. I'm not aiming for some utopia. That's Jannah. That's in the next life, right? In this world, we're just aiming for a civil society.
Okay. I'm out of questions. Thanks for putting up with my questions and my interrogation at times. But I'd just like to give you the opportunity, if there's something I haven't asked you, something you particularly wanted to say, you can say it now if you like. Okay.
Oh, to summarize all that I've said is really, in a few sentences, is quite simple. And that is, Sunnis and Shiites have always had two trajectories in Islam. And these trajectories have had a little bit of tension at times and more tension at other times. Our job, our role, our goal really is to minimize physical tension, to minimize the bloodshed. It's not necessarily to merge the two strands together. That's not going to happen. It's not going to happen in the foreseeable future. So as long as we are able to have these two communities live and let live and minimize the extremist elements in both, inshallah, that is a realistic goal. And I think that that is an achievable goal if clerics on both sides have the same vision in mind. And in the end, success is only with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.